Theorists have talked about this. In West Africa, that the students, the university students, represent an important and potent political force as well. And so their commitment to their learning is involved with a political commitment. So for example, I was even teaching A Grain of Wheat, and what that book meant to them was so different from what it would mean to the students here, I think. I mean, they were much more focused immediately on the neo-colonial theme then, because that's what their reality, they felt their reality was. So that would be one difference, at least, that I found between the two systems. So.
All that's true, I believe. The level of, in my talk, I was talking about how quality people in Africa has become a kind of pan-African property. It is true, if I travel, say to Zimbabwe or Ghana, the way people perceive I'm saying, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I was saying that what they were saying is actually true, and I was saying that, you know, what I was saying earlier during my lecture about African literature being a Pan-African product. And I was saying that when I go places like Zimbabwe or Nigeria or Ghana, you know, or Eritrea, you know, or any part of Africa, you know, the way people see me, the way, you know, that when students recognize that I'm around and so on, you know, that eagerness, that sort of light in their eyes, that identification is, I find it very, very moving indeed, you know. And I'm sure the same for when Soyinka or Achebe or Amakai Du, you know, goes to any part of Africa and they recognize the person, you know. They are received as if they belong to that particular country, you know. It's our writer, not simply that writer who belongs out there to West Africa. So in that sense, you know, despite many things have been said about this literature, it's been a very, it's the one thing which, in a sense, has become an expression of an African. And that's why it's gratifying that we still keep on talking about African writers. I'm very happy about that, as opposed to say Kenyan writer or Nigerian writer, you know, although it's also important to particularize, but that notion of Africa is still very, very important. So that sense of what you're saying, people taking this in seriously because they have an impact on their own lives, you know. In the area of literature, it is translated in terms of how they actually identify with the writers, you know, of the different parts of the continent.
Of your novels, is there any one of them which you would consider to be your best work as far as plot structure, character development, theme, etc.?
That's a very difficult question. I don't know which writer was asked a similar question. I don't know, it's too much. I can't remember who it was, but who said something about it. It's like asking someone to say which of his children I see that fine. That kind of, you know, difficult. Meaning that, you know, you like one for one aspect, you like another for another aspect, and so on, you know. Like, for reasons which have nothing to do with artistic character of the world, I like the books which have been translations from my language. You know, the novels which are in two languages and which are available in translation, that is Matigari and therefore the Cross, they have a special place in my heart. Because, not because they're artistically better than the ones I wrote in English, you know, but because they have another significance for me in terms of this whole area of writing in African languages, you know. So, if you ask me to say, okay, I lean towards, say, the one across in Matigari, but I hate to say it's not because of that they are artistically superior to, say, Petals of Blood or A Grain of Wheat. On the contrary, in fact, some books like A Grain of Wheat and and that is something I may have gained from youthful exuberance, you know, youth is also very, youth is also a revolutionary force in so many ways, because sometimes it's not afraid to break through barriers, you know. Whereas, you know, when one gets a little bit, you know, like my age now, I begin to be a bit hesitant, I become more conservative in terms of what I feel I can do and cannot do. But at a certain age, one feels there's nothing they cannot do. If you're writing the best novel that has ever been written, now I'm a bit more hesitant. You know. So they may have gained also from that, you know. But these are that I've gained from. These are the more recent ones I've gained from this other commitment to their higher, which is really writing in another language, and then the books being available in other languages, including in English.
I have a question regarding the relationship between language and meaning, and I'd like to use an example from The River Between. When he weighs of the land and takes him up to the top of the mountain to see the sacred Marungu tree, would the meaning have been the same if you had written it in Gikuyu or English?
There's a difference. I don't know how to. Okay. There's a difference. I don't know how to put the difference across, but there's a difference. It's very hard to put my finger on where the difference is. I know there's a difference, not ultimately, because ultimately I test the books I write in Kikuyu. Sometimes I like reading to audiences the English translation, and sometimes it's very interesting to see that the reactions to some parts are the same as, you know, people react if they were hearing the same passages in Kikuyu, you know. And so on, you know. Nevertheless, there's a difference in the way language organizes time, the order of events, you know. There's a way what comes before what, you know, in terms of sentence structures, you know, and so on, you know. There's that, you know, difference. Nevertheless, you know, a book like The River Between, it's also very much influenced by the rhythms of speech of the Kikuyu language. That's why I was talking about borrowing, that this novel was borrowed heavily from the rhythms of life, you know, and imagery of African languages, you know. So you make it sound African, you know, although it's an English sound, you know. So in that sense, novels like those of Chinua Achebe, you know, so they are very African in another sense. Things fall apart when you read it. An African language, you do feel echoes of an African language. You do actually get a sense of the rhythms of an African life, you know, and so on. But in terms of, say, as an African, when I read Things Fall Apart, I can get extra enjoyment from it because, like, when some of those characters talk, in a sense, if I make a mental translation of how they are saying it in Kikuyu, it actually can be very fun or very interesting. Because I can hear, although he's speaking in English, I can hear, I recognize so well because I know it in Kikuyu language. That would be the difference, I suppose. I can't articulate very well, but I know there's a slight difference in the way time is ordered and so on. A Kikuyu person can tell the difference much more when they read, say, a novel of mine written in Kikuyu, meaning that in Kikuyu originally and then translated, then they can tell a difference. Because if they start by reading the Kikuyu version fast, they feel very difficult. They find it very difficult to accept the same sounds, you know, in English. Yeah.
This might be a good
time. I was doing the same thing, but by the way, I once visited Russia and went to the Soviet Union. And I was enthusing about Tolstoy, you know, 18th century. They say, oh, we went on Tolstoy. war, and I talk about war and peace and so on. And then it became curious. They asked, in what language did I read War and Peace? And I said, English. And they looked very puzzled. I said to them, how can Tolstoy really come across, you know, in English? As if it cannot be translated. It's usually not translatable, and so on. The same thing can happen with words, but you know, it can happen.
This might be a good time for a bathroom and stretch break.
Reconvene for our last 25 minutes or so of question and answer. We can do it.
This is
going
on.
First part is just when do you think you'll finish your new novel? And the second part is, having taught for many years in the U.S., which of your own novels do you think Americans and relations
with? The last question first. It depends on which is being taught where. By whom? I think that was both by the degree of enthusiasm by the different, you know, teachers. Because I go to places where they love with no child. You know? I go to other places where they just love the river between. Other places where this favor is a grain of wheat, you know, petals of blood, you know, at various times, devil on the cross. And now recently I've been hearing about Matigari and so on. I think it depends very much on the teachers, or how, what text they were introduced to first. Mm. Yeah, then so that's why you get all these differences of enthusiasm about the different, you know, text. What I like though is that generally they seem to be able to relate to some of the things, and that was probably more important to me, and they seem to relate. Whether they are reading Matigari or with my child, they are to relate to a lot of the issues. Or to see the linkages. You know. Sometimes they don't see, but sometimes most people do see the linkages, and this is actually, you know, important. Occasionally you come across a reader who says, although they come from here, who says a particular book spoke to them. You know, that's a very interesting reaction. In other words, they're not saying the book taught me about Africa, but how the book spoke to them. And so I think very, very important also to, you know, to a writer when they hear that kind of a book has made that of impact to a particular individual. Of my book, I don't know. I thought, to be very frank, I thought I had finished it last March. I mean, and I even had it printed. And we print. And then I had sent a copy to my publisher in Kenya, who is going to bring it out. Because what they're going to do, I'm going to have three publishers, one in Kenya, one in England, and one here in America. The American publisher, African World Press, they won't bring out, first of all, an American edition of the original Kikuyu fashion. Because although there aren't many Kikuyu readers here, but for some reason, he wants to make a point. Yeah? Then he'll probably bring out the American edition later. The Kenyan publisher, he wants to bring out the Kikuyu version simultaneously with the Swahili version. So it means that I have to get a translator, or rather they have already got a translator who will be working on the Swahili version. So the Swahili version will come out at about the same time as the Kikuyu language version in Kenya, you know. And then hopefully after a year, and if there is an adequate translation, it should then come out in English with the London publisher. Who is waiting for it?
And can you translate
into
English?
I don't know who. You know, when the first novel I did in Kikuyu language, Devil on the Cross, I did the translation myself. The second one, Matigari, was done by Wangui Wagoro. It's a much better translation, in quite frankly. And but this one, I'm not sure who will do the translation. because it's so much dependent on language. The action of the novel, some of the important turns in the narrative sequence are not very dependent on the motelier character of some of the phrases and words in two language. It's almost in African, or in language for that matter, you get words which have multiple references, you know. It will demand a translator who is very, very well versed in the language. And also, I don't know how some section will be done, quite frankly. So it depends on, I may have to get a translator with whom I can work very closely. Yeah. I'm going to have to get my wife interested. So I can be very closely, sort of, you know, there, you know. So, yeah. But I'm very excited by the new novel because I'm using a lot of, my inspiration is coming more and more from the oral narratives, you know. So the new novel, I'm using rumor as a literary device, which allows me to move freely in time and space, you know, a lot more. Because with the rumor, you're never sure what is true or not true, you know. And you can play around for a novelist, this is good, because then you can do many things with the rumor. Mm-hmm. You know, you can talk about many places, because one can say, because a rumor can be about anything. It's like a dream. You can dream about heaven, death, 1,000 years ago, you know, or anything can happen in a dream. So that's where it frees one from the realism of ordinary time, you know, and geography.
Most of our high school students are very open-minded. However, sometimes their parents and some of our faculty members are not. What would you say to these people when they say that, no, we cannot read your novel in the classroom because it deals with some culturally sensitive issues?
Well, first of all, you know, I think we work so imagination. It's very important to let the students really, in this case, be the judges, in the sense, you know, you shouldn't interfere too much in terms of what they're going to read and so on. Because the stories will dictate their own responses. Secondly, obviously, I don't have to deal with prejudices, you know, because a prejudice is a prejudice. I mean, that's what it is by definition. So you don't know how to deal with it, you know, except just continue hoping that the books and the stories will speak for themselves sufficiently to persuade others to give them a chance by looking at them. Because what you say reminds me of, oh, I love telling this story, let me tell it to you. You know Brecht, the German writer? Brecht, the mother of Brecht. You know this play, the Galileo? Okay. Now, you remember, of course, in the old world, you know, sort of, you know, the world was supposed to, is it? The earth was supposed to be the center of the universe. Mm-hmm. In the old sort of Catholic order, or the old feudal order, mm-hmm. was going around the world, you know, going around. And the earth was the center of the universe. And you remember in the play, Galileo, through the telescope, he had been discovered Copernicus, I think, you know, confirmed that actually the world, the earth goes around the sun, not the other way around, you know. And he's summoned to Rome, you know. And you get all these mathematicians are called, you know, all the learned people of the times, mathematicians, philosophers, there's a scene in which they are called, you know, disputation to prove Galileo is wrong. So you remember that is a very wonderful scene in the play where Galileo had a telescope. You know, he does not want to argue with them. He wants them to look through the telescope because he knows that if only they would look, then they would see that what he is saying is true. So the whole play, not the whole play, but that particular scene is with Galileo, please, begging them, please look at the microscope, look at the telescope, you know, Then the mathematician would say, yes, yes, but before I do that, mathematically speaking, you see, mathematically if you put plus A, this, and this, it's really impossible that this thing can prove A, B, C, D. But he would not look through the telescope, you know. So it's very funny because Galileo is begging them, please, gentlemen, please trust the evidence of yours. Please look through the telescope. All the philosophers and the mathematicians, they refused to look through it. So I'll say with anybody with prejudices, I'll say, please, please, read the books.
My question is more political, and it has to do with Kenya. I wondered what you see as the future of Kenya politically as far as the one-party system and Arap Moi and then Leaky also for a while. So. And also your opinion on that.
Well, first of all, of course, I mean, there's no one-party system now. It's supposed to be over. In other words, there are very many parties in Kenya currently, you know. But we're in a state of democracy which covers lack of democracy. So it is an ironic situation where a multi-party system, which is supposed to be a symbol of democracy, but which covers, because a cover of so much intolerance and state-engineered intolerance, including state-engineered ethnic warfare, you know. So here you get a state, which is supposed to be democratic, you know, which actually is behind so much of ethnic, you know, violence. You know, there's some areas in Kenya where other opposition parties cannot even operate normally in the no-go, we call them Kanu areas, you know, no-go areas and so on. So to me, although there have been very important gains, it's more outspoken in Kenya today than there was in 1990 and so on, there are more political parties, more newspapers and so on. That's a definite gain. The negative side is that now this is used as a cover to show to for people to justify any murder, you know, because Kenya is democratic, you know, you can't accuse it of not being democratic. Why? We have many political parties. So even when they kill people, ethnic warfare, or when they don't allow organizing to operate, even when they arrest journalists, you know, priests, there's some priests who've been beaten very, very badly recently, and so on, you know, then you cannot really accuse the regime of lack of democracy because of a two-party or three-party system. You know, so it's a facade which is covering a lot of intolerance, you know, and so on. You know. Now, my position, I'm really very frank in this. You know, I've said, and the people I work with have said, there's no way Kenya is not going to go through a democratic transition for as long as Moi, in particular, and the regime is. As long as they are the referee, there's no way, and we said this at the beginning, there's no way the Moi regime is going to allow a democratic process. They very well mean they be ousted in a democratic environment. And this is proven to be true. Every time he has been forced to, for reasons, make concessions, he done that temporarily to steal the opposition, and then he goes ahead and goes back to whatever he wanted to do. I believe that for some of the regime is there, you know, there's not going to be democracy. And what I'm fearing more than now is that by the time more it goes out through whatever process, age or whatever, you'll have so polarized the Kenyan society. That's what you may get at the moment, maybe, you know, more ethnic strife in Kenya. And Kenya will have to fight and find soul searching, do anything to avoid the kind of Kenya whose foundation has been created by the Moi regime. You know? So we like to see Moism ruling Kenya if the after Moi is actually gone. So in that sense, I'm very pessimistic. Optimistically, I'm optimistic in the sense that I'm just hoping that more and more Kenyans see this through this. And there's some clergymen in Kenya, some churches in Kenya, you know, some, you know, who are able to see this, you know, from all ethnic groups, who are able to see these machinations. Whether their progressive vision will be strong enough to counter the dire consequences of the Moi regime, even when he is not there, I don't really know.
Very sensitive subject, but it's hard to discuss the culture, the history, and the literature of Africa without discussing female circumcision. So what do you want us as teachers to talk about in terms of a cultural, historical perspective, and a modern perspective of female circumcision?
I would say we discuss all aspects, you know, all that, you know, of circumcision. What I don't like about this discussion is when it's one-sided, you know, when, you know, there's a proto-custom, but when it's discussed, even if the conclusion is that it should go and it's negative, it's okay. I have no problem with that, you know. Because in many communities, circumcision used to play a very, very important role. It was part of the social fabric. Put it this way, when the society I come from, good society for reasons, when the entire legal was organized on the basis of age groups, you know, how you move from one age set to another set, circumcision for you was a very important rite of passage in the sense that it was the legal difference between when one is 18 here or 19, you know. In other words, before circumcision, whether a girl or a boy, you couldn't be held accountable for anything. In other words, you're still a child, you know. It's after that, you're supposed to be an adult, therefore accountable for A, B, C, D, and so on. So, if one is going to put that in a context, that's very important. Then show how maybe the ideals they met by the, you know, are no longer, you know, obviously so much has changed now, you know, the certain needs which were met by that circumcision or that rite of passage probably do not outweigh the negative consequences of the same procedure. And it's not just circumcision, any other custom that people may hold. At one moment it may have had very positive consequences, or the benefits may have outweighed the negative factors. Societies do change, customs do change, you know, and what was positive yesterday may not necessarily be positive, you know, today, you know, or today maybe the benefits are outweighed by the negative, you know, consequences of that. You know. So it's really discussing the whole thing, you know, in all its complexity, which is important, and not simplify it, you know, as if, you know, sort of men, you know, sort of stay there with sort of, you know, I've had some discussions where it looks as if the male always sort of sat there with machetes, you know, ready to cut up the female into pieces or whatever. But to put it in a context, then if the conclusion, whatever the conclusion is, you know, they have no problem with that. If the conclusion, particularly the one which is pioneered by many progressive African women, who say no, it's no longer, you know, whatever good it may have had, if it had any, is outweighed by the negative, you know, consequences of circumcision, you know, that's fair. Well, good, let's get rid of it. You know, I have no problem with that myself. But it's one-sided. I feel very uncomfortable about a one-sided discussion, either for or against.
One more question, Nellie?
There has been some discussion, and if I may add, some confusion surrounding your name. And this morning we did an exercise voicing a name. So can you tell us what motivated you to change your name? Was it because because of some kind of rejection of the Western domination, or was it more of a cultural thing?
Yeah, the name, this is another sensitive subject. Now, the reading of the capital, not subject over to, for which African content, so just like any other content, it's very important to emphasize that society's change is very, very important. And culture in Africa is not something static, you know. And so that's wrong to think about Africa as if, you know, things have remained and always remain. I think that essentialities that somehow or other never. I see there's a mechanical African culture, you know, like one per time they say 1, 2, 3, 4, you know. The essence really of African culture, as of many cultures, is change. You know, change in an orderly manner. When the contradictions in a given society help to work themselves out, you know. Otherwise, it's sort of static, you know. So the real culture of Africa is really the culture that recognizes change, you know, self-renewal, if you like, you know. So inherent in that culture, that's real. So some customs will be outmolded, they die away, new ones, and so on, come into being. And that's a natural way of society, you know, developing, and so on. Let me come to names, though, because names are, the way I look at it, that naming is like a language, you know. And I'll be talking about how the way language helps us to organize space, you know. When a language is a way of identifying space ourselves, just as a name. It's a way of naming the world, you know. You name the world through language. Now, how did I have to change my name? First of all, when I was born, I was given the name Gogewalio. It simply means Goge. It means a lot of work. I mean, Goge means work. I'm son of Fiong, my father. Then somewhere along the lines, I was baptized in Christian sense, James, you know. And in those days, you could not even need to baptize an African name. I don't know why it was so important when you're baptized, you might be given a European name, you know. So James, you know, I became. And then when I went to school, I used to have a very hard time knowing whether to write James, Gogi, James T, Gogi brings young in the middle and Gogi at the end, you know. So even some of the publication I did, because I started as a journalist in the 60s, you read some of my other articles, you know, they are signed by, they come under the name Goge, JT, James T, James Goge, and it's agonizing. You know, so it's sort of a name becomes an really uncomfortable. So it's coming as agony for me, you know. Now, later, rationalizing the changes. I read a lot of slave narratives. Then I noted one pattern. Now, when an African was taken from the continent and put on the plantation, he was given the name of the owner of that plantation, so he became brown. Then later, when he was bought or taken by another plantation owner, then even the previous name was now changed. He was no longer brown, he was Smith, depending on the new owner, you know. So that actually set a whole train of thinking. Then later I was able to connect this with actual direct colonialism. And I realized that what was happening, that the slave system was actually happening under the direct colonial system. You know, it's a transfer of exactly the same thing, you know. And now in Africa, not enough. Now you come there, you go to a place, and you have to change your name. You become James, you know, or Nelly, you know, you say that, you know, or Nelly, and so why Nelly? Why ideas? Why not Google? Why not any other names? You know, it will not be a problem if it was a case of one or two people. In other words, exceptions. Is there one or two Africans that called James, Mary, what does it matter? But what is the whole tendency? That is something wrong. Because you are not talking about exceptions. Like you might get one or two people being called after names. But not entire body of, say, Algerian people taking on other names. But we African people are the same, you know. So for me, the name is a simple pointer to an identity, you know. So now, but this has other implications, I realized. That's what Kim and then, you know, I realized for every African person, given our historical situation, every African person who went to school and who achieves something is a leader, whether they are in parliament or not. Why? Because for every educated African person, there are hundreds of other people who look up to that person, you know, who want to be the way that person is. So all the symbols of whether dress or what or names and so on, you know, become symbols of what that child ought to be. You know. So you have this situation then where Africans achieve